first is the Anti Capitalist Bodybuilder by Adam Stella. If I'm pronouncing his name wrong, I'm sorry. And that's in Jacobin. And then Fascinating Fascism by Susan Sontag, which is from the New York Review of Books. And then Out of Body by Kyle Kugler from Ultra. Kyle's here today, so if I mess up anything that he wrote, you can yell at me later. Okay. So I'm going to read, I'm going to show you a poem, and then I'm going to show you two other things, and then I'm going to tell you a story, and then I'm going to try to, like, stretch an uncertain connection between all of them. So this is the first part of the poem.
It's not showing up on the projection, but it's like, the slides up, so.
Oh, okay.
Is it too dark?
It might be too dark. Well, do you want to read it?
Yeah. It says, the first 3,000 times I told someone I was an artist, I was lying. Every time I say I'm making art, I'm lying, but hopefully a little bit less.
Okay, and then this is the first thing that I'm going to show you, which is also kind of dark, but just a heads up. So this is a clip from a piece of Nazi propaganda. So there's like a long point in this where there's pretty much like a straight on swastika, so if someone finds that disturbing, you know, obviously we're here to critique that, but like it's only about 4 minutes long, so you can like step outside and come back. Can the music, or is there sound?
That's as well. Thank you.
super creepy. So this clip is from Triumph of the Will, which is a film made by Nazi propaganda artist Leni Riefenstahl. And it's basically a film that, well, so you've probably heard of the Nuremberg Rally, which happened in 1934. That whole rally was basically created to be filmed by her as a Nazi propaganda piece. And so here's the second thing that I'm going to show you. So this is a quote from Autobody. Bodies of all types enter as early as 5:30 a.m. The crowd is largely made up of 24 to 34-year-olds, mostly white, although not entirely. The bodies come in all shapes and sizes, but like the auto parts that came before them, they become conditioned by use. Quadriceps will soon begin to show above the kneecap, along with the trapezius of the upper back and neck that are displayed in the banner above the entrance. Calluses at the base of the fingers from squeezing a pull-up bar, scars that run vertically up and down the shins from a barbell as it's pulled off the ground on the deadlift. One generally shared goal of these bodies is to reinvent their present state. And now here's my story. Okay, I know, we're gonna tie all this stuff together. But my junior year of college, this is an embarrassing story. Okay, so my junior year of college, I was working out maybe two or three times a week. And I had a really weird way of working out, which is that I would take all the weights that I was using into the women's bathroom, specifically into the stall, and I would work out there. So at one point when I was doing that and I was weightlifting in the bathroom, I happened to drop a weight, and it must have been like a 10-pound weight, like right on the toilet bowl. And of course, it just cracked. Like, they fell apart, there was water going everywhere that just like smashed. And if you thought I did the right thing and went and told someone, then you were very wrong. And I did absolutely nothing. And I just pretended that I didn't have, like, booked it. And so you're probably like wondering why I was working out in the bathroom and also what everything has to do with one another. So around the time when I was learning how to write, it became super obvious that there was something wrong with me. So here's an example of my handwriting as it is like today. And I found out, and then later as like other people around me like started to excel at sports and stuff, I basically started to regress and I wasn't making as much progress as other people. And I found out later that I had a motor sensory issue, which meant my brain and my muscles are just not very well connected. And it also meant that for a very long time, I couldn't really like engage with my muscles the way most people did when they were learning to be coordinated or learning to play sports. So for me as a kid, that meant like no more roller skating, no more dancing, no more writing. And like keep in mind, I had no idea what was going on or why any of this was happening. And for a very long time, like any kind of physical activity in front of other people was pretty much an exercise in like physical and verbal humiliation. Fun stuff. So basically, the reason that I was working out in the bathroom was because I was still pretty afraid to, like, even this was like junior year of college, to like do like physical activity in front of people. Like, I tended to shut down. I had a really hard time like telling myself that I actually had a place in those kinds of spaces, or had a place at the gym, or had a place, or like really belonged there. And I had like, you know, I was really interested in working out. I was really interested in actually getting better at those things that I hadn't been good at before. But I felt like, and you know, I would read about it, and I was engaged with that culture kind of, but I felt like a complete imposter. I just had this really bad imposter syndrome. And it was interesting to me because I felt sort of very similarly in the art world, because like as an artist who can neither draw, sculpt, write, or really hold a camera well, I constantly like felt like an imposter in the art world. And even now, when I've developed my own art practice independent of these challenges, I am like frequently asked for sketches and small models that I can't really provide for people. So a long time at the gym, you know, and both at the gym and in the gallery, I sort of had to develop strategies for addressing this imposter syndrome other than hiding in the bathroom. So I developed one really interesting strategy. It's called lying. And I wasn't necessarily lying about doing these things, but sort of lying about engaging with them. Hold on, sorry. These are... See, I don't actually belong here. Okay. So, this is slightly misleading. I wouldn't lie about going to the gym, but while I was there, I would spend the majority of my time sort of pretending I knew what I was doing, like pretending I had a clue when I didn't, pretending how I knew how to do things, watching people and modeling behavior off of them until I felt more comfortable. So it took me over like a while of doing that to sort of like figure out how to do things. And on reflection on this, I sort of realized I had a very similar strategy when it came to the art world, where I was also kind of flying blind and having to develop my own strategies. But here again, I sort of found that like my best practice was this sort of like fake it till you make it, like just sort of like you go there and you know that you're a freak, you know you're not, you don't really belong, but you still do it anyway. And it leaves you feeling like isolated and lonely, but you like make yourself do it. So after drawing the parallels between these two worlds, I started to notice other parallels. And some of the parallels I noticed were like an exaggerated or like twisted mimic of general society. Both the fitness world and the art world have a really twisted relationship to race and gender that neither wants to address. In the art world is still predominantly white, and it's like mostly like white artists and white gallery owners that gain the most respect and the most material power. But the art world like steals from many non-white cultures all the time. And I think both the art world and the fitness world, you can see a pattern of people like sort of using black and brown bodies while someone else, usually like a white person, like gains the most profit from their labor. So I think also in general, both the gallery and the gym are sort of a strange place where people go to do labor, but what they produce is extremely abstract. In both places, we sort of say that we don't want to be seen, but we often go there with the exact expectation of being seen. Both have a strange sort of off-brand preoccupation with appearance. Both worlds are actually very obsessed with shape and the appearance of bodies, but somehow both worlds seem to think that their obsession is somehow like less base or purer than the rest of societies. I think that the fitness world, though obviously there are massive exceptions to this, is in some ways far more accepting of different body types than the art world. Personally, I've not met a lot of successful female artists who do not fit like a pretty specific body type, not to say that they don't exist, but awesome. There's been times where I've actually wondered if I'm skinny enough to make it as an artist, which I've never wondered if I'm skinny enough to work out. And I would argue that the gym sort of obsesses and like sickens itself, or the fitness world, I guess, obsesses and sickens itself over this idea of purity, while the art gallery frets constantly over authenticity. But both worlds seem to want to bottle and serve passion with discipline. So this sort of leads me back to the readings that I mentioned. So this quote is from the Jacobin article. Okay, for many men, the promise of a better life in the city was laden with the new problems of urban work. Mental exhaustion, a feeling of separation from one's body, boredom, and a lack of freedom in one's work. So Sotella, in this article, traces the roots of bodybuilding back to the turn of the century when middle-class men were pouring into the cities to take like middle management, white-collar jobs. A solution to this physical self-alienation many of these men turned to was sort of like the beginning of what would be known as like bodybuilding and like weightlifting. The ritual, and I'm quoting again, the ritual of building one's body allowed middle-class men to reform a rugged and masculine sense of self, a sense of self that was undermined by corporate capitalism each day. It also helped white-collar workers alleviate their fear of being overthrown by muscular immigrants, a sentiment echoed today by the "This is our country, not theirs" legion of Trump-supporting bodybuilders on bodybuilding.com. In the gym, masculine ideals were expressed through strenuous training and a well-developed body, and the threat of what Roosevelt called race suicide was temporarily averted. So to Sotella, the birth of weightlifting represented some sort of undermining of the capitalist structure while simultaneously playing straight into the racist nationalistic fears that clearly haunt our country today. So just as an aside, I was sort of skewed out specifically by the way he used the phrase race suicide in this paper. Race suicide is obviously a really toxic term. The eugenics movement has a history in that term. It was basically the fear that white people, specifically like Anglo, well-to-do white people, were going to stop having babies and die out. And those were the people that everyone thought was like good shit at the time, so people wanted to keep them around. And Roosevelt used that term like very, like he used it in a really specific way, which was his, Roosevelt was terrified of birth control, and he was really worried that middle-class women, when they went to college and started reading and becoming educated, were going to start taking birth control and stop wanting to, and like not want to have children anymore and choose to not have children because they were going to choose to not do that labor. Because it's shitty labor and they were going to read books and realize that it sucked and not want to do it. And so he wrote a bunch of letters, and he actually wrote a bunch of stuff about, specifically about sort of placing the burden of like averting race suicide on women and sort of telling them that the right thing to do. This was specifically like not just women in general, like he only cared about like upper middle class, like white women having kids. That was his, really important to him. So to me, it's like, I understand why he used it there, but it also seems like a little bit misplaced in an article that's specifically about like men have, like working out, but unless like the idea is that they just got really hot and then people wanted to have babies with them. I don't know. It just, yeah. So I guess what also makes it sort of troubling to me is he brings up these ideas and then kind of drops them, at least I felt so, and I wish he'd actually like dug more into the tension here between weightlifting's potential subversion of capitalism and its worrying connection to like ethno-nationalist theory. But his focus is like more on celebrating the former, and he pretty much and doesn't really return as much as I would like him to the latter. Here's like, I think sort of his conclusion. It's not his like last sentence, but it's sort of the conclusion he comes to. Self-fulfillment, wholeness of mind and body, control over one's body and ownership of one's labor, and the products of one's labor speak to the kinds of activities that all of us find meaningful. Whether it's the middle-aged man planting tomatoes in his garden, or the young woman writing poetry on her front porch, we all yearn for freedom, creativity, and control in our labor. Bodybuilding arose because the people interested in making money off of other people's labor began to eliminate the kind of work that embodied these characteristics at a rate that matched their own bureaucracy's rapid expansion. So you can see here that we sort of agree about this, like, that there is this sort of, like, seems to be, like, a kind of innate connection between, like, the creative arts and, like, sort of, like, intentional, like, strengthening and exercise and, like, those kinds of, like, physical activities. I think, obviously, there is the fact that, like, performative sports and poetry and art like sort of existed before capitalism as we know it now. But I also think that like the idea that bodybuilding and in connection creative pursuits are popular because we are seeking to regain a sort of freedom lost to this sort of bureaucratic capitalism is really intriguing. But I also think there's like ways we need to like sort of look at it in a really balanced and careful way. We need to consider the massive fitness industry, which the art world mirrors in some ways in our expensive schools and cartoonish art market. We also need to address the way that for many of us, our bodies are a commodity. For women especially, putting labor into our bodies and therefore our appearance through working out and shaping ourselves in different forms is either broadly or very, very directly value driven. And what I find more difficult is that Zatella doesn't really return to address the roots that he identified that bodybuilding had in like white middle class race anxiety, which seems really important since I think that for many people of color, the idea that value under capitalism isn't ever related to your physique and frequently your strength or athletic ability is like pretty offensive. But beyond that, I want to highlight something else. The pursuit of creative freedom through the impulse of the natural body, that somehow weightlifting and poetry connects the body back to this true pastoral nature, the natural beauty of the body straining to be stronger, the ideal form is the sort of chiseled man, strength embodied and obvious as the beautiful pinnacle of what we are naturally supposed to be free to do. The idea that we are creating, doing what we want, growing stronger, just because it is this sort of like pure impulse is really inspiring. And these things are sort of celebrated both in the art world and in the world of fitness. And it's like, for an obvious reason, those are appealing concepts. But those concepts, I think, have a historical dark side that we sort of, that we like have to address. Okay, I'm going to show another clip now. And this clip is kind of long, so at some point I might skip through it.
Thank you.
could probably skip through to like 2 minutes long diving scene.
Wait, did you want me to?
No, it doesn't really matter. I can fill in the rest. It's a lot more like exaggerated, like semi-nude bodies performing various physical activities. So that was kind of weird. And what's like particularly sort of weird about it is that was, I'm guessing, as some kind of some film student project that they made, inspired by and using different pieces of Riefenstahl's, who's again the Nazi propaganda artist, film Olympiad. And to me, that's a really weird choice of subject matter and a really weird thing to sort of take inspiration from. Personally, I think that. But so Olympiad was like Riefenstahl's documenting of the 1936 Berlin Olympics. And while she claimed that she made this film for the Olympic Committee, she was commissioned by Goebbels to make this film for Hitler's 49th birthday. And it was sort of aired in 1938 on April 29th in Berlin as part of the festivities that like celebrated his birthday. So, you know, a lot of people say that there's this rumor that, because she basically films the whole thing, you know, there's two films, it's the whole 1936 Berlin Olympics, it's the Jesse Owens win and all of them, and there's this rumor that Goebbels didn't want to show the film because of the gold won by an African-American athlete. And that's not true. The Olympics were really important to the Germans, beyond just wanting their German team to win. While the Nazi ethos centers around the superiority of the Aryan race, the ancient Greek like sort of principle of the perfect masculine form performing and struggling athletically is also like really significant to them, like in and of itself. And like ancient Greek imagery in general was very important to the Germans at the time. And the Olympics, like, even when their own athletes lost or other athletes won, sort of still fulfilled like a really specific aesthetic that was sort of important to them. Just by like the nature of her display of like the athletic bodies. So as Susan Sontag asserts, every piece and part of the film was intentionally produced as a celebration of Nazi ideals. She says, "The choreography alternates between ceaseless motion and a congenial, static, virile posing," and then sort of talking about totalitarian art in general, she says, "The rendering of movement in grandiose and rigid patterns is another element in common, for such choreography rehearses the very unity of the polity. Hence, mass athletic demonstrations, a choreography and display of bodies are a valued activity in all totalitarian countries." But like despite this origin, as you saw from that short project that I just showed you, which was made in 2015, Riefenstahl's work continues to be used as a source of inspiration in the art world. In Fascinating Fascism, Sontag dissects this acceptance of Riefenstahl, despite her sort of unforgivable history, and she refutes the notion that Riefenstahl's work somehow rose above its Nazi roots through beauty. That obviously the idea that anything can like rise above that sort of thing, like through beauty, in and of itself is like a false concept. But she asserts that our acceptance of Riefenstahl stems from the artistic appeal of fascism in and of itself. So Sontag, in her part, sort of chalks that up to our sort of cultural obsession with a really specific type of beauty, especially, you know, in the art world and outside of it. So here I have a quote from her from Fascinating Fascism. "The change in attitude towards Riefenstahl lies in a shift in taste, which simply makes it impossible to reject art if it is beautiful. The line taken by Riefenstahl's defenders, who now include the most influential voices in the avant-garde film establishment, is that she was always concerned with beauty. This, of course, has been Riefenstahl's own contention for some years. Thus the Cahiers du Cinéma interviewer set Riefenstahl up by observing fatuously that what triumph of the will and Olympiad have in common is that they both give form to a certain reality itself based on a certain idea of form. Do you see anything particularly German about this concern for form? To this, Riefenstahl answered, I can simply say that I feel spontaneously attracted by everything that is beautiful. Yes, beauty, harmony, and perhaps this care for composition, this aspiration to form, is in effect something very German. But I don't know these things myself exactly. It comes from the unconscious and not from my knowledge. What do you want me to add? Whatever is purely realistic, slice of life, what is average, quotidian, doesn't interest me. I am fascinated by what is beautiful, strong, healthy, what is living. I seek harmony. When harmony is produced, I am happy. I believe with this that I have answered you. So, obviously, she's talking about a really specific type of beauty. Strangely and uncomfortably, Nazi filmmaker Riefenstahl went on long after the war to publish a photography book documenting 2 years she spent living with the Nuba tribe in central Sudan. The book was called The Last of the Nuba. The book, which hopefully would be heavily scrutinized now, was incredibly successful in the late 70s, and obviously Sondheim was not a fan of this book. And for good reason, even pretending that we can put aside the fact that the author was a close personal friend of Hitler's, the anthropological studies of white artists that take place anywhere from Africa to the other side of cities that they are born in are usually a monster composite of preconceived racist notions, their own personal narrative, and exotifying aesthetics and biases. And Riefenstahl wasn't any different, but she did have a really specific bias, obviously. And so here's another set of quotes. Okay. Although the Nuba are black, not Aryan, Riefenstahl's portrait of them is consistent with some of the larger themes of Nazi ideology. The contrast between the clean and impure, the incorruptible and the defiled, the physical and the mental, the joyful and the critical, a principal accusation against the Jews within Nazi Germany was that they were urban, intellectual bearers of destruction, corrupting critical spirit. The book Bonfire of May 1933 was launched with Goebbels' cry, "The age of extreme Jewish intellectualism has now ended, and the success of the German Revolution has again given the right of way to the German spirit." And when Goebbels officially forbade art criticism in November 1936, it was for having typical Jewish traits of character, putting the head over the heart, the individual over the community, intellect over feeling. Now it is civilization itself that is the defiler. In Riefenstahl's casebook of primitive virtue, it is hardly the intricacies and subtleties of primitive man's social organization or thinking that are being extolled. She is especially enthusiastic about the way that Nuba are exalted and unified by the physical ordeals of their wrestling matches, in which the heavy heaving and straining Nuba men, huge muscles bulging, throw one another to the ground, fighting not for material prizes, but for the renewal of sacred virility of the tribe. In celebrating a society where the exhibition of physical skill and courage and the victory of the stronger man over the weaker man have, at least as she sees it, become the unifying symbol of communal culture, where success in fighting is the main aspiration of a man's life. Riefenstahl seems only to have modified the idea for Nazi films. So, Riefenstahl's Nazi principles are carried on through the vision she projected onto the bodies before her, carried on through her celebration and consumption of what she saw as natural and primitive, strong and pure. To me, her projection of athletics and purity slash naturalness is telling, because it's so much of what I see happening in the specifically like health and fitness world, but also in some ways in a sort of slanted way in the world of art. So I have two quotes here. One on the left, I have Sondheim's conclusion on why an art audience was so susceptible to Riefenstahl's work. And on the right, I'm returning to Kugler's auto body piece. And I actually think that that passage is more relevant to what I just said, so I'm going to read it first. Culturally, CrossFit harnesses the nostalgia for a simpler past and combines it with the romanticization of the natural in order to craft a comprehensible view of the present that embraces precarity by helping prepare for everything. This is not simply a pre-lapsarian fantasy, though the idyllic and savage primal is coupled with modern science in an attempt to recreate a born-again human that specializes in the unspecialized. As lean management forces all employees to be flexible in their working hours and expertise, CrossFit demands the same from the consumer. CrossFit is the figurative and literal lean production of the body. To avoid precarity, one must embrace precarity. Do a little of everything and then do more of it. The fragmented sense of progress in lifting a heavier weight or beating an old WOD time creates a fleeting autonomy in a managed subject. Through CrossFit, despair and uncertainty are replaced by trust in the primal, one simulated shoveling exercise at a time. So obviously there's a ton to unpack there, and I'm only going to be talking about a tiny fraction of it. But and I think this sort of invention of the new primal is really interesting to me, and I'm going to come back to that. But I think also the Sontag piece is really, this conclusion is really important as well. It is generally thought that National Socialism stands only for brutishness and terror, but that is not true. National Socialism, or more broadly, fascism, also stands for an ideal, and one that is also persistent today under other banners. The ideal of life as art, the cult of beauty, the fetishism of courage, the dissolution of alienation. Sorry, I'm having trouble reading it from there. Sorry, if I might put some here. The fetishism of courage, the dissolution of alienation, an ecstatic feeling of community, the repudiation of the intellect, the family of man under the parenthood of leaders. These ideals are vivid and moving to many people, and it is dishonest and tautological to say that one is affected by Triumph of the Will and Olympiad because they were made by a filmmaker of genius. Riefenstahl's films are still effective because among other reasons, their longings are still felt, because their content is a romantic ideal to which many continue to be attached. So I sort of started this by comparing the world of the gym to the world of the gallery, and I'm not trying to argue that either of these spaces are like fascist spaces, but I do think they are spaces where people go trying to find some of what fascism also idealizes. Community, beauty, strength, and natural authenticity. And what I struggle with is that I feel for many people who come to those spaces don't actually find it. And they find those spaces to be alienating, they make us feel like imposters, they make us feel alone, and unnatural or inauthentic. I have spoken about my own personal experience with this, but I actually think this is not uncommon to feel in that space or other spaces that people tend to enter. So people who come to these spaces, like, yearning for those things, sometimes, like, continue yearning. And that is why, like, sus art and sometimes sus ideology, like, find homes in galleries and gyms. CrossFit is not a fascist anything, though, as Kubler explains, it does come out of Silicon Valley. And personally, I think that the Silicon Valley tech lead ethos has a disturbing Ubermenschian quality to it. But I do think CrossFit and workout programs like it exploit that feeling of alienation and craving by placing an emphasis on this sort of new primal person that can be created. What you are paying for when you pay for programs like CrossFit, which are not cheap, is the community with which you can fever dream your way to this new, like, both the new and old ideal person. In Autobody, Kugler outlines, among many other things, the tension around community in the history of the fitness world. He compares the weightlifting gyms of the 60s, an often like hostile, aggressive, and close-off but close-knit community, with the gyms of the 70s and 80s. In the 70s, workout machines began to be mass-produced and were marketed as easy to use. This welcomed more people into the fitness world by seeming to eliminate the need for community. Understanding this history makes it easy to grasp the reason for success, for the success of CrossFit and programs like it, which package and sell community an ethos that is a purely capitalist one, but it gives you the feeling that you're actually buying something else. Like buying a new ideology. So where does this leave us? well, I'm not sure if I managed to wrap all these ideas or things together, but I'm also like still personally even unsure if I should be here, like giving an artist talk, referring to myself as an artist. I still walk sort of stony-faced into gallery openings and in and out of the gym changing rooms, hoping that no one notices that I don't belong, that I'm a freak, and I'm pretty sure that I'm not alone. The word freak is kind of important to me. I know that some people consider it a slur for people with disabilities, but as someone who has a disability and who is also really weird, I feel kind of comfortable like moving past that. After all, we live in a post-freakum dress society. So, the word also ties into how I'm going to try to like wrap all of this together and on a more positive note. One thing that really caught my eye in Autobody and kind of started like part of this train of thought was sort of weightlifting's more anarchic roots in carnival culture. Kugler explains that one of the early 20th century sites of American fitness community was Muscle Beach, which opened as a public park in 1934 in Santa Monica, California, under the Public Works Administration's New Deal. The park quickly became the meeting ground for war veterans and all types of fitness enthusiasts. The workouts that happened there were a strange amalgamation of many different fitness styles popular at the time. But a lot of what was practiced at Muscle Beach were heavily influenced by circus routines of strongmen and acrobats. And I'm quoting here, trapeze work, backflips, lifting, and throwing of other people, all of these variations were as much demonstration as training. There was no program or specific workout routine to follow, and much of the community was built around learning how to do certain moves and how to build a good routine. While people came here to exercise, they also came there to put on a carnival-esque tight show of feats of strength and agility. Because the park was free, the audience grew quickly, and a large community started to form. Notably, for the time, the women were sort of part of this community, both as performers and as fans. The carnival influence and the atmosphere created a space where fitness enthusiasts could mingle with their fans with little division. But the freewheeling carnival feel of the park was its downfall, and in 1959 it was shut down with a judge determining that the park endorsed freakish, homoerotic, and unbalanced activity. Kugler writes, hold on. Though couched in the conservative terms of the 1950s, the condemnation of the park also hints at a deeper fear of so many war-scarred, disciplined proletarian bodies brought together in a carnival-esque atmosphere. The carnival is one of the origin points of Muscle Beach's telling, with its history as a symbol of semi-permanent transgression that inverts traditional power relations. In a strange twist of history, America's weightlifting legacy thereby shares at least part of its genesis with May Day, the raucous, brightest communist holiday. So this is an important thing for me to note, because I think that whereas the Nazis sort of traced their appreciation of beauty and like strength to this sort of like ancient Greekish ideal of this of the strong man and this sort of like perfect masculine figure performing like very set specific like feats of strength. I think like as a country or like as a people, like now we can start to like maybe trace like a new route of like strength and beauty to something like much more freeing, like a carnival freak show or like something that allows like not only like more liberation but also something that's like would create like less of a sense of this like less of a sense of an imposter syndrome, less of a sense of alienation, something that's like sort of has less boundaries between participants and outsiders. And that's something that I kind of feel like, you know, even if you're not thinking about the gallery or the gym, there's probably spaces in everyone's life that they walk into and they're like, I don't belong here, or I like, there's cultures that like, you know, I don't feel part of. And so I think that's just some kind of something that I like to think about when I'm like in those spaces, is kind of like, how do you reshape those spaces to sort of like tap back into like what you actually came there to achieve. So some things that I didn't actually address, contemporary far-right art, I'll sort of just throwing things out here. In Poland, there's a group called, I don't speak Polish, so I'm not, I think that's pronounced the Karsonals, but it means the dwarves, and they're an alt-right art group from Poland. They would never identify themselves as such, but they really are such. Their art is very like based around like anti-Semitism and like anti-immigration work, even though they would describe themselves as sort of apolitical and anti-political or not. And you can also look at the LD50 show that happened in London. It was like a huge scandal. And it was like basically an alt-right art show. And I don't know why they did that, but they did. And then I sort of compare the jam to the gallery as a way of comparing two different cultures, but obviously that is incredibly limited, and that there are, you know, there's the studio, there's the gym, there's the mat, there are a million types of ways in which people engage with both art and fitness, and like, you can divide that culture up into a million different things, and I think a lot of what I said could be refuted by talking about one or those other things, but that was kind of like my way of summing up in just a small, short talk about these two different spaces, and you talk about my own art at all. This is like, I am interested in making more work that engages with like with gym culture in general and sort of the shapes that are present in that. But so this is me like starting off like thinking about that. Anyway, the end.
How much do you binge?
Hughie. Yeah, that's a not accepting question.
So I think that your analysis of the gallery was a kind of alienating space is pretty right on. It's a fairly common understanding of, especially when you go into sort of blue chip galleries where this kind of commercial space is a very, very exclusive, and not intellectually, but financially.
Mm-hmm.
Like the most exclusive you can get is financially exclusive, and of course the big galleries are exactly that. But thank goodness there are other kinds of spaces to deal with art. So for example, the artist from space, this space, you know, where it's basically a bunch of degenerates in the best possible way. And so I think that there are, you know, self-organized, like, different kind of spaces that are able to navigate art that isn't about competition. So I think I'm wondering if you could fit that in there somewhere, or do you also feel?
I guess like for me personally, like when I was starting to go to galleries, like even like, and when I talk about galleries, honestly, like I am talking about like not-for-profit, like artist-run galleries. Like I don't spend any time in blue chip galleries, no one's buying my art, you don't need to go into that. Like, you can buy my art if you want to. But, like, I think, like, a lot of, like, those spaces have a very strong potential for feeling alienating, I think, to a lot of people. You know, I the first thing that jumps into my head is I know that a lot of galleries, like in Portland, and I'm sure this happens in Seattle, get very criticized for being heavily white and incredibly alienating. So that's just, I think that is the most obvious form. I think there's other ways in which they can be cliquish, or they can be, you know, people want to just show their friends, they want to show a show of their friends' art, or they want to show a show, you know, and I think that's not like a criticism of any specific gallery, but I think that it's like something to be aware of is like, you know, even if you get a bunch of degenerates together, that can be pretty alienating to someone else, you know, and I think like in all kinds of spaces, there's always going to be someone who like feels like an outsider. And I don't think that like, I don't think we're ever going to create like a sort of communal space that feels totally inclusive. And I don't know like if that's really the goal, but I do think it's like something to think about, you know, and I don't think that like, I don't actually think, and this might is not a necessarily a popular opinion, that like underground art spaces really like, they're part of the art culture and they're really important, but I don't think that they sort of subvert art elitism. And I think that like being aware of that is one of the first steps of like moving on from that. And obviously I really appreciate this space, and like artists like me like depend on this kind of stuff, but I think that like as that kind of artist, I need to be aware that like when I'm putting on a gallery show, there are people that walk into my show and feel incredibly uncomfortable, no matter how underground that space is. Sometimes I feel really uncomfortable, so.
I, so familiar with art spaces and stuff, but one of the things that, like when thinking about like gyms or fascism or those sort of roots that that I think a lot about is like this need for progress and maybe like more of a general sense that like going into the gym feels like a space where the progress can happen. And you can kind of like be like, okay, like enough with all like other bullshit that I can't control. Like I have like power to make some sort of progress, and that like I always want to fall back to progress to be the like everyone can have their own progress and it can be like inclusive to whatever anyone wants, but I also understand that like this idea that like progress is linear or whatever mm-hmm. also can be like very fascist, and I'm like curious about like what that's like in our world, or like if there's these like metrics of progress in the same way that it would be in a gym.
It's hard because I feel like this is like where the idea, you know, where like maybe the comparison sort of falls apart, because it's like, you know, when you work out, there are specific goals that you can place for yourself to do. And like as an artist, you know, I will be like, okay, this year I want to have this many shows, and like, but it's much harder to be like, I'm going to have this show and then I'm going to go to this gallery, and every time I have a show, I'm going to make three more contacts. But that is kind of like, you know, even though it's harder, that is kind of how it works. You know, you go somewhere, you meet people, then you get, this is my first artist talk. Now I have had an artist talk goal, like artist goal completed, I can bench more. Like, and you people are going to follow you on Instagram or like whatever. And I think that those things like are comparable. And I think it's interesting that you bring up progress, because Sondheim sort of talks about the like how failure isn't necessarily like physical failure at something isn't necessarily like a subversion of like a sort of more totalitarian ideal, like the actual like straining, it's the actual like doing of the thing. And I think like in art spaces there's this sort of like the suspended animation of like having a show. I think about that sometimes, so like when you're actually having a show or giving a talk, you're sort of like in this is like suspended animation of like you're like the sort of you're ceaselessly in motion going nowhere kind of for a while. And I feel like, I don't know, I'm sort of drifting here, but that sort of is what that makes me think of. Yeah.
Could you say that like in a certain sense, like with like the gym, you know, you're constantly tracking your progress, like Kyle said, through one simulated shovel dig at a time. I think in like in art, would you say that like there's a sort of like a thing where like a given work of art is sort of like a like progressing like process sort of embodied, like sort of like dead, like a dead labor sort of thing?
Yeah.
It appears before you as its process, you know, especially like I think contemporary art is probably more process driven. Do you think that there's like sort of comparison you can make there between the sort of like obsession with like perfection of form through the process of like developing art versus like nailing your fucking deadlift, you know?
Yeah, and I think it's interesting too because like process is such a loaded term in art, you know. A lot, there are artists who like the overview of all of their work is just about how they make the work. Like, in fact, like making the work in and of itself is like more important to them than the actual object. And you know, I think for a lot of, like especially for weightlifters, like form, the form you hold while you're lifting is incredibly important. And so I feel like I sometimes see like some like commonality between that, where the actual fetish, right, is not the object that's created. Like the fetish is not like, you know, even like your body and how you're, like a lot of times it is your body and how it looks after you've been weightlifting, but like the fetish, the object of the fetish is like, is the form that you're holding, like the actual, like in that like tiny moment when you're actually doing the lift, that form becomes like the object of the fetish. And I think for a lot of artists, like that can be traced to, you know, like the incredibly obsessed with like, you know, a certain type of brushstroke, or like artists who like do more sort of like a lot of like, I know artists who their all of their work is just about like, what new trick can I do with this like new tattoo? Yeah. Exactly. Like, it's like, what new trick can I do with this like new audio sensor that I found, that I programmed? And you go to their show and it's like they've like programmed an audio sensor to like, I don't know, like make sand fall or something. And then you're like, wow, this is really cool, but I can see that like the actual object that you're showing me is not this pile of sand, but it's like this new trick that you learned. So, I don't know.
I've got a question also kind of deal but they, I guess about the implications of kind of like form and also like the communal aspects of a lot
mm-hmm.
of the, I mean, both weightlifting, lifting in the gallery you talked about, I guess like, you know, it seems like kind of a part of the problem with the gallery is that like there's a communal centering on certain forms, aesthetics, and
yeah.
like similarly like within weightlifting, within things like CrossFit, like these all ideologies form around, you know, kind of the group nature of it.
Mm-hmm.
It reminds me of you, a writer I forget who talked about just kind of like soccer similarly as this like important as like the fascist ideal in sport, in that like you have this like communal activity where you can simultaneously have this like well-oiled machine that always allows for the momentary like brilliance of a single individual reinforcing the group. And I'm curious what the implications of that are on like basically like the more individualistic forms of like martial activities. Because it seems like something like boxing or MMA, like those are all always like clearly like really like martial forms, and like also clearly develop a lot of very regressive ideologies or. Not right ideology, sorry. But at the same time, it seems like some level of that like commonality of form is lost.
I feel like, you know, obviously I'm coming from this, like, most of what I'm coming from is like the art world, and so it's hard for me to like, I'm trying to like build a synergy between the two. But I think, I guess, I don't know if this is going to answer your question, but when I think sort of about, like, so, like, in art movements, when there's, like, really specific art movements, you do get, like, right now, virtual reality, right? It's a really, really small, like, because of the way it works, because of the materials that you have to make it use, it's, like, a very small community of people that are doing it and have access to it and are sort of, like, learning from each other to do it, and so it does force this kind of commonality, but because it's this like sort of commonality through need and through need of learning, whereas like my art, which is mostly self-taught to me by me, I tend to like, I don't have that necessarily. And it's, but they're also like developing this like new, like a whole like new field of art. So maybe that's like less relevant to what you were saying, but I guess, I don't know. Can you rephrase your question? I feel like I'm sort of missing it here.
I'm not sure I get it fully either.
Okay.
I guess like going like is like a is the communal is like the combination of the communal like some sort of like communal and the aesthetic like basically always.
I don't think so, because I think like one thing for me is like that I felt like I was trying to get at here is there are things that we think of as not communal, like there are certain types of like working out that we think of as not communal, but they all like they still like. Necessitated community in some way, and community is still sort of desired in those spaces. Like, it's like, you know, you hear over and over again, if you're trying to get into working out, that you should bring a partner, you should bring a friend, you should bring a bunch of friends, you need someone to spot you at the gym. Like, there's always this sort of, like, sense of community, and even beyond needing community necessarily, it's like, there's the whole, like, being alone in a space where there's many other people being alone, I feel like is something that needs to be, like, thought about. So I think that, like, even when it is not necessarily like a communal activity, you're still engaging with your either the presence or lack of people being there and like engaging with you. So I feel like, you know, obviously like some like training, like physical training, like MMA, like there is obviously a built-in community to that. But I think that like, I think that, you know, there, even when that doesn't exist, then there creates this sort of like need for that community, which is your, so you, then you're like engaging with your lack of it. Yeah.
I really love hearing you talk.
Oh,
thank you so much for being here. You've talked a lot about beauty and described some of the things that like are sort of pop culturally or regarded as beautiful historically, but I'm really curious as to like, you know, what do you find beautiful?
Well,
you know, like, you know, and that's a really difficult question,
yeah.
And kind of cheesy, but like, cause you know, like when we put a Nazi artist on the spot and ask them what they think is beautiful, it's really easy to be like, oh, there's lots of flaws with that,
mm-hmm.
of course, you know. So I'm kind of just curious, like, do you? Cause a lot of your work, I'm just kidding, cause a lot of your work is like. in text, and it's not like a lot of imagery.
Yeah.
So I'm curious as to like, yeah, your relationship with beauty, what you find beautiful, and also, is something, is it even an image?
I think that is sometimes, it's really interesting that you actually asked that. I had a, on the ride up here from Portland, I had a really, we talked about, my friend and I talked about, that friend, talked about, like, beauty and sort of the ways in which, like, when we think of, like Nazi ideals of beauty, we think of, like, an Aryan man with, like, blonde hair, and he's, like, really strong, he's smiling and laughing, and he's throwing wood in a pile, but also, like, sort of the birth of this sort of, like, Nazi beauty ideal was actually, like, their land and their mountains and how beautiful they thought their mountains were and how much they loved their sort of cottages up in the mountains and their, like, rolling forests. And it's actually this much more, like, natural type of beauty is what I think, like, they really engaged with in some senses. Like, the beauty of the German landscape was as important to them, if not more so, than the beauty of the German people. And I think so... sort of, I went from there when you look at, like, Manifest Destiny, right? So a lot of the ideology behind Manifest Destiny was very tied into the beauty of the American landscape. And I think that, like, when you're dealing with something like beauty, it's this kind of, like, loaded term that it's hard to ever find, like, one precise thing to hold on to that doesn't, like, feel like it's corrupted by these ideas. And I think this goes back into the place of the art world being very, like, you know, so that's very stressful for us as artists because we're like, oh, well, there's all these ideas like cramming our heads and now we can't engage with it. But also, like, we need to be authentic. So, like, I'm going to, like, what is the thing that I find, like, the most authentically beautiful? And the moment you think of something, you're like, oh, it can't be that because that comes from this other place, so it's not actually authentic. And I think for a long time, for me, my way of sort of dealing with that was to sort of go to, like, language and be like, you know, what is it about language that I find beautiful? What is it about poetry that I find beautiful? Was that images had all these connotations. And then, you know, the more you look at that, the more you find that, like, language in and of itself is just made up of smaller concepts that aren't authentic. So it doesn't, that's not even authentic to you. And I think sort of a lot of my work is actually dealing with that struggle between, like, where does language actually come from? And, like, what is, like, can any of these ideas that we, like, hold as beautiful, like, even if we express them through written language, like, are they really ours, and do they really, like, have the meaning that we thought they did, or do they mean something else entirely? And does that matter? Like, does it matter if, like, it doesn't matter if I find something beautiful just because someone else told me that it was beautiful a long time ago? Like, does it, don't I still find it beautiful? I did a project really recently called X Fantasy, where I was really honing in actually on imagery specifically that I found beautiful when I was, like, much younger, and it has to do with, like, fantasy art and anime and, like, all of these, like, high octane, like, really intense things, like pink and green and, like, really, like, bright colors, and, like, in that I think I was trying to be like, here's all the stuff that I find sort of, like, stimulating and beautiful, and I'm just going to put it all into, like, one space at once and, like, see, even though I've never engaged with it before because I found it inauthentic, like, see if it has an authenticity to it when I do it. And I thought that it did. I felt, like, engaged, and when I engaged with it, I was, like, engaging with it, like, authentically. So I think that's, like, an interesting question. I don't know. I think sometimes you just kind of have to, like, take a risk and be like, actually, I'm going to own this thing. And then if I find out that there's something fucked up about it, I'm going to be like, well, I own this thing. I authentically think it's beautiful. And so that the fucked up nature of it, like, belongs to me as well. Like, I think you can see this too, if you're thinking about gender and, like, sexuality, you can be like, well, I'm attracted to this ideal. I know I am, but I can also, like, tell the ways that that's, like, fucked up, or if there's something fucked up about the way that I'm relating to this attraction, you know? And I think that that's, like, actually, like, as artists, like, really important for us to do, you know, when we're, because we are engaging, a lot of times we're engaging with other people's bodies. And so acknowledging that, like, the roots of that is, doesn't mean you have to disavow it, but it doesn't mean you have to, like, say that it's there.
Thanks, Genevieve.
Yeah.